second World Revival Conference. The first was started by Wayne Weaver in Sugar Creek, Ohio. And we are continuing with the second one here from Rosansea, North Wales. My name is Brian Mason, and looking at revival and intercession as part of revival. And the title of this talk is Then the Fire of the Lord Fell. It was a time when Elijah, God's prophet, felt that he was the only one left, felt that he was the only man of God left, and that all Israel had turned against God, had deserted God, had rebelled against God. But God had his man. And even in these days, when to be a Christian costs everything, and it seems that we may be the only ones left who have not rebelled against God, God knows all about it. He knew all about the situation which Elijah was in. He had allowed this to happen. And God himself had his own solution. And it's just the same in these days, that God has allowed rebellion. The rebellion, what is rebellion? It is witchcraft. It is of Satan himself. It is from the very pit of hell. Yet God does allow this to happen, because when there is a turning away from God, when the hearts become not just cold, but become defiant, become thinking, I am God, that's rebellion. That's witchcraft. That's standing against the Almighty himself. Because God created man to have fellowship with himself. Sin is rebellion. Because sin places itself in place of God. Sin says, I have a right to myself, and rejects that perfect fellowship which God has created man for. But even in the darkest of days, and undoubtedly Elijah lived in a period where it was the darkest of days. And since then, even before Elijah, there were periods where it was the darkest of days. Remember, Sodom and Gomorrah, and what God did there. The fire fell, and the fire consumed. And in these days too, in fact down the centuries from Elijah, there were periods of rebellion, periods where God had to take his people into exile. Yet God never loses control. God is the Almighty. God is sovereign. Satan is an irritant. He looks to interfere in human affairs and blinds, as he did in Elijah's day. He blinded the people because those who should have been making known the ways of God had been turned unto the ways of Baal. And there are many Baals, because Baal is whom? Baal is Satan. And Satan has many, many workers, many demonic spirits running around, possessing people and doing everything that he can possibly do to prevent himself ultimately being cast into the lake of fire. And God, in his perfect ways, allows this to happen. Yet there are specific times when God will raise up his man. He raised up Elijah. He raises up his intercessors down the centuries. He had those like a John Wesley, which saved Britain from the very depths of hell with a mighty move of the Holy Spirit, bringing revival to the hearts of those who had not given themselves to Satan. And revival is God himself coming into the midst. And that's what we will see in this account with Elijah. And that's what we will see in these days too. Because these days are as dark as they were at the time of Elijah. They're as dark as in the time of John Wesley. But yet God has not completely withdrawn. He will have the ultimate say. And at the moment he is preparing, ready for the time when the fire will fall. And I, as one of God's intercessors, am being used to go to different places, and even from this house in Rose-on-Sea, to move God, who is upon the throne, to act, to honor his own word, to move God as Elijah moved God, to fulfill that which God himself has purposed to do in these days. So we're not to think, oh, everything's beyond hope. No, nothing's gone out of control. God knows exactly what he is going to do. And he brings about a situation which, as far as one, a man of God or a woman of God is concerned, that they're not going to be moved by what they see, but by what they believe. and the believing comes through the Word of God. And this record with Elijah and the prophets of Baal is there to encourage us in these days, is there to show us that ultimately God will let things go so far and then say that enough is enough and I shall act. And I have my men and my women throughout the world who have not bowed the knee to Baal and will never bow the knee to Baal. Let us now turn to the record of Scripture. 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 17. And it came to pass, when Ahab saw Elijah, that Ahab said unto him, Art thou he that troubleth Israel? Remember that Elijah had called a drought because of the sin, of the rebellion, of the people who should have been in an understanding of God, who should have been worshipping God, whose lives should have been obeying the commandments of God. And Ahab and his wife Jezebel, they were the instigators of this rebellion. Undoubtedly, there were wicked evil spirits at work in Ahab and Jezebel. Rebellious spirits. And Elijah, as God led him, was one who obeyed God. Elijah was set apart for God. He was not moved by what he saw. He was moved by what he heard from God. And when God had called him to bring about, he moved the one on the throne. And that's what intercession is. Moving the one on the throne, moving the Almighty God to act. And when Elijah called upon God for a drought, a famine, it was not a moment too soon or a moment too late. And God heard that cry, because that cry had been implanted in the heart of Elijah. And God answered that cry. And it's the same with this intercessor and with all like intercessors worldwide. What God wants to do, he first brings it to our hearts. He speaks to us. We hear. And we obey and act. Act before God. moving him and bringing into being that which God wants to be brought into being. That's why I've got that confidence. No matter how dark the days appear, how much Satan appears to be running amok and laughing, as it were, at Bible-believing Christians, God will have the final say. And as God speaks to my heart and speaks to others' hearts, He leads perfectly in what He wants to bring about, what prayers He wants to be prayed, what intercession He wants to be made. And because it's the Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit sent from God, the same Holy Spirit who lived and worked through Jesus whilst He was during His earthly ministry, it's the intercession of the Holy Spirit within us who brings about the answer, brings about God doing that which He has determined to be done. Let us keep that in mind. We're not in defeat. God's never lost a battle yet, and He won't lose one, because He's the Almighty. And on the basis of the Word of God, I am the Lord, I change not. When God says, I change not, He means exactly that. That what He has done in the past, no matter how dark, how grim, how impossible the situation may appear to God's people, He has not changed. And Elijah was to prove that. And having called this drought, this famine, and it lasted rather a long time, and Ahab had done his utmost to try and find Elijah. And the day came, the day had to come, when Elijah was seen. And what did Ahab look to do? He looked to place the blame on Elijah. That's the way of Satan. Blame anyone but himself for what evil goes on in this world. Now Elijah was having none of this. He's having none of the nonsense of Ahab. And replied, I have not troubled Israel. He brought it right out into the light. And that is what is so needed in these days. Jesus Christ said, I am the light of the world. God is light. Satan is darkness. John makes that very clear in his epistle. And the works of darkness are the works of Satan. Let us be very, very clear on this. God is love. Satan is not love. God is light. Satan is darkness. There's always the contrast. They're always the opposites. And there's always the counterfeit. Let us be clear on this these days, that what is going on in the world is that there is a God of this world, not the Almighty God who sits upon the throne in heaven, but the God who, with the permission of the one who sits upon the throne, seeks to do his worst, seeks to do the works of evil. And every work of evil which goes on in this world is not from God. It is being used by the instrument of God, who is Satan himself. Because Satan couldn't do a thing without the permission of God. Let us be so clear on this. That's why there's a confidence that the time will come when ultimately the fire will fall and God will consume that which is not of himself, that which is not got his own life within. And Elijah had great confidence to stand as God's intercessor, as God's representative before Ahab. And it's the same in these days that God's intercessors can stand because they know whom they have believed. They know whom lives within them, the Spirit of God. And because of this, they too can stand against the very strongholds of Satan, can stand against the principalities and powers of darkness, no matter what form they may come. And because of the power of the blood of Jesus, and because of the power in the name of Jesus, they stand before God, not dealing with men and women on earth, but standing before God and moving God to act, to fulfill his own plan, his own purpose. And his own plan is that every creature shall hear. Every creature, every person in every nation of the world shall hear of what God has done in Jesus Christ. And that God seeks to bring back to himself men and women into fellowship with himself. And here we are. There is this confrontation between Ahab and Elijah. And Elijah, he was the one who had the authority. I know we're talking of Old Testament here. But who has the authority in these days? The Holy Spirit. And when it is the Holy Spirit who's living his life in us and through us, he has the authority. The authority to move God the Father through the name of Jesus and through the power of the blood of Jesus. Because the greatest victory came out of what appeared the greatest defeat. The cross was not a defeat. It was a triumph. It was a victory. And he made it so clear here, did Elijah, in that ye have forsaken the commandments of the Lord, and thou hast followed Balaam. It's always the forsaking of the commandments of the Lord. in these days, it's been the forsaking of the Word of God and looking to bring in its place the philosophies of men and women, the philosophies which take God right out of it. At least they think they are taking God right out of it. But that's a delusion. God cannot be taken out of it, because God is still in control. He allows them to do it, all right. But ultimately, they have to answer to him. And they followed Balaam. Now, who is Balaam? There are many Baals. In the Old Testament, there were many Baals, idols, gods, but not the Almighty God. And in these days, too, there are many, many Baals, idols. Oh, there have been church buildings, all right. Nothing at all to do with God. People worshipping their Baals, worshipping anything which is against God. What did Elijah say then? Now therefore send and gather to me all Israel unto Mount Carmel and the prophets of Baal. 450. Oh, he knew about it all right, how many there were. And the prophets of the groves, 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. Oh, they were lapping it up with these ones, these prophets of the groves. They were living in luxury. But they were to meet their comeuppance. So Ahab sent unto the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together unto Mount Carmel. There was a specific time to come to a specific place. And all Israel was invited. The people were to come, and there was to be a decision made. It was being brought out into the light. This is what's happening in these days and through the intercessions of this servant. That intercessions have been made over the last few years. And what is coming out into the has coming to the light. You may not think, you may not realize this, but that which has been hidden for years is coming, has come and continues to come out into the light of God. Things that you'd never thought were possible, but yet the light of the intercession has brought out into the light of God. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, this was very clear. It was a challenge to the people to decide. And there is a challenge to the people to decide in these days too. How long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. Again, two opposites, God and Baal, God and Satan. And it was in the light now that there had to be a decision between which one the people were to go and follow, the people were to obey. And the people answered him not a word. They couldn't answer a word because they had been so blinded, so under the works of the darkness of Satan for years, that the word of God had been silent. But Now, the word of God once more was being heard. And the word of God in these days too cannot be silenced, because God has his men and his women who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Worldwide, he is calling his gathering. Those who have not bowed the knee to Baal, in that which even dares to call itself Christianity, which has bowed the knee to Baal. These are ones and twos, a little companies here and there. We're not talking here of huge numbers of that which dares to call itself Christianity and church, that has compromised. Compromise means compromise with Satan. Because you don't compromise with God. You obey God. But by obeying God, it's through that fellowship with God, through that love with God, through that understanding of who God is, that God himself lives within those who have absolutely given their lives to him and accepted the pardon for their sins through the cleansing blood of God the Son. Then said Elijah unto the people, I only remain a prophet of the Lord. But Baal's prophets are 450 men. He thought he was the only one left. But God knew otherwise. And the message to those who know their position in Christ, those who know whom they have believed, know whom to whom they belong. You're not on your own. God has his men and his women. I'm in contact with them, with many of them, in different parts of the world. Even over the last month, I've been amazed at the numbers that I've been brought into contact with. People I'd never known and would never have known, but God himself has brought them into contact with me and led me into contact with them. And there was to be this test, this deciding factor. Still in control, he's not lost control at all. It was God working on behalf of himself through Elijah. And the test was to be on something which the people should have been aware, that of sacrifice, that of offering unto God. Let them therefore give us two bullocks, one for the false prophets and one for Elijah. And let them choose one bullock for themselves and cut it in pieces. Here was Elijah giving the instructions, because whether these worshippers, these prophets of Baal, had ever offered a pure, true, acceptable sacrifice unto God, don't know. There was only one acceptable sacrifice. There is only one acceptable sacrifice. And ultimately that was to be through the Son of God, Jesus Christ himself. The one perfect sacrifice through his own blood. But here in the time of Elijah, there was a set way of doing the offering of sacrifice unto God. And he was saying, cut the bullock in pieces and lay it on wood and put no fire under. This is the important bit. No fire under. Because the God who was going to answer would have to act in a supernatural way. Would have to act in a way which would leave no doubt to the people as to who God is. And I will dress the other bullock and lay it on wood and put no fire under. And call upon the name of your gods. He didn't say to them, call upon the name of God, but the name of your gods. Because these people were in such rebellion that they had seemingly many, many gods, but not the true God. And I will call upon the name of the Lord. That's confidence. And the God that answereth by fire, let him be God. And all the people answered and said, it is well spoken. Yes, when Elijah had said to them, right, how long will you halt between two opinions? They were silent. They had nothing to say. But once he had made it so clear what this was all about, then they could see that there was a way of deciding, for them to decide, as they say, for God to decide as to whom God is. And they took, yes, these false prophets, the bullock which was given to them, and dressed it and called on the name of Baal from morning even until noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. Yes, that was their prayer. O Baal. Completely different to O God. They were praying to whom? They were praying to Satan. And there was no voice, nor any that answered. And they leaped upon the altar which was made. Oh, they became more and more desperate. Because they were calling, and the people were watching, the people were listening, and the people were seeing that here was that which was false, here was that which was evil, here was that which had had them in darkness for years, had blinded them for years, had led them away from God for years. And it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he is talking, or he is pursuing, or he is in a journey, or peradventure he sleepeth, and must be awaked. Oh, my, was coming out into the light here, that they were worshipping a God that couldn't answer them. And worshipping gods that couldn't answer them. And they cried aloud and cut themselves after their manner, with knives and lancets, till the blood gushed out upon them. They became so desperate. And that's what Satan does. He calls his people to be desperate, to harm themselves. because they don't know the living God. They don't have the hope within them of God, the God who is love, the God who gives them his love, his life. That's the contrast. Satan, he's the one who drives to wants to suicide. He's the one who causes the heartache, the despair in this world. It is God who has the answer. Yet the darkness in the world is keeping millions upon millions upon millions away from coming to know the living God, the one who hears and answers prayer. And it came to pass, when midday was past, and they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, that there was neither voice, nor any to answer, nor any that regarded. There wasn't a God there that cared for them. Yet God, in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is a living Christ and is able to meet all the people at their point of need. Not just some of the people, but all the people. Yet there is that reluctance to come to him. Because of the darkness which has descended upon the world. And that's why the intercession is needed, to lift the darkness, to bring out into the light of God the need to come to God in Jesus Christ, to have their individual needs met at whatever point they need meeting. Because Jesus Christ is life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So hour upon hour went by, and nothing was heard. The fire didn't come. So what did Elijah do? And note at what time he did it, at the time of the evening sacrifice. Who knows when there had last been an evening sacrifice. But the time came, and Elijah came forward and acted on the commandment of God, acted in faith, acted without a shadow of doubt that what he was doing, God would intervene and God would answer. And he made it absolutely humanly impossible for the fire to come. Because let's read it. And with the stones he built an altar, so that was the start, to restore that which had been destroyed. In the name of the Lord, and revival is restoring, its restoration of that which has been destroyed. And he made a trench about the altar, as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order, and cut the bullock in pieces, and laid him on the wood. and said, "Fill 4 barrels with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood." Yes, here we are. And he said, "Do it the second time. And they did it the second time. And he said, "Do it the third time." And they did it the third time. And the water ran about the altar. And he filled the trench also with water. So it was absolutely saturated. It was swimming with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah, the prophet, came near and said, now what did he say? He prayed to God himself. The others had prayed to Satan. Elijah knew his God. And he had that absolute trust, absolute faith that this God, his God, whom he knew, whom he believed, would not fail to answer and fail to act. Because the honor of God himself was at stake. The people were there. They were watching, hour after hour they'd been watching. And God now was ready to answer, ready to restore his own honor amongst those whom should have been his people. And he said, "Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word." He hath done it for himself. He done it because God had spoken to him. God had shown him, and God had called upon him to act in faith, and he did act in faith. And why? Because the prayer goes on, "Hear me." Most of prayer goes upon deaf ears, it goes up into the air. It doesn't touch the one upon the throne, because it's not been offered for the honor and glory of God, but for selfishness, centered upon the self-life. "Hear me, O Lord, hear me. That this people may know that thou art the Lord God." It was God himself who was going to show the people that there is still a God who wants to be their God. "And that thou hast turned their heart back again." That is revival, turning back again. God himself coming down into the midst. God himself taking absolute control and filling with his own presence. That there is not a shadow of doubt left. That there is God in the midst. God with us. That was when Jesus Christ Emmanuel came. God with us. And because Jesus Christ ascended back to the glory of the Father to be with him, that the Holy Spirit could be sent. And it's not just a case of God with us, but God in us, sharing his fellowship. That fellowship which he had given way back to Adam, and Adam had forfeited it. And God restored it in Christ. God, he couldn't fail to answer this. He couldn't fail. No, he heard it. It was prayer which moved the one on the throne. The throne heard and the throne answered. Because the Almighty upon the throne heard and answered. And what happened? It was a supernatural intervention of God himself. Then the fire of the Lord fell. That was supernatural intervention. Nothing left for doubt there. No uncertainty there. Because what happened when the fire fell? Not only did the fire consume the burnt sacrifice, but the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench, that it was all consumed by the very glory of God. And that's revival. God coming down in his glory, and men and women seeing that they're out of it, completely out of it. And when he does come down, lives are transformed, lives are changed, lives are brought into the fellowship which God wanted them to be when he created man. And it's all there in these days too, because the sacrifice was God himself on the altar of the cross at Calvary. It wasn't a bullock, as in the case of Elijah. It was God himself, nailed to that cross, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who redeemed, who bought back that which Adam had forfeited in the Garden of Eden. He restored, he reconciled all that had been lost, all that had been forfeited, and the price was the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And as the writer to the Hebrews tells us about one sacrifice. No other sacrifices are needed. The one perfect sacrifice for sin forever. And because of that, when Jesus cried out, "It is finished," that's exactly what it is. It is finished. Nothing could be added to what he did. And the veil into the holiest of all in the temple was torn, supernaturally torn, from top to bottom, showing that the way unto God had been restored. And the invitation is for every man, woman, and child in every nation today, not to bring anything of themselves as an offering. No, not offering money, not offering works of themselves, not relying upon man's intervention, but accepting that God has opened the way through his Son, Jesus Christ, and it is a gift, entirely a gift, that were not bought with silver and gold, but by the precious blood of God himself. The invitation is there and will remain there until God, in his perfect timing, brings a close to this old world and then there will be no more opportunity when Jesus has taken those who are his to be presented to the Father. And when they've gone, the Holy Spirit who dwells within those who are Christ's on earth, the Holy Spirit will have been withdrawn. There will be no further conviction of sin and no more opportunity to receive the life which God is offering at this time. And what happened to those prophets of Baal and the prophets of the grove? The victory was there. The victory was seen by the people. So Elijah said unto the people, take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape. And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. There's a finality there, an ending there. And there will be a finality to those who are not in Christ, those who have not accepted the pardon from God, who have not repented of their sins. And that finality is that they will finish up with the one who they have chosen to follow throughout life, Satan himself. And where Satan ends up, they will end up, in those awful torments that Satan and his cohorts will experience forevermore. Yes, the opportunity was given to decide which God the people would choose. Either choose the Lord God or Baal. There's no one else to choose between, either God or Satan. And the choice is yours. God will bring about opportunities. He will remove these great darknesses which have been blinding people from seeing what Jesus Christ has done. And that's revival, God himself coming into the midst and giving further opportunities in these days to come. This has been a message which is for the glory of God and the glory of God alone. Amen.
Thank you.